I will now talk with Dr. Guido David of the UP Institute of Mathematics and a fellow of the OCTA Research for his take on government's latest statements and response to the pandemic. Good afternoon, Doctor, and thank you so much for joining us.
Yes, good afternoon, Ms. Ray and viewers of ANC.
You've already said that the Philippines has seen a genuine surge and predict that the numbers will spike further to 80,000 by end of July, 130,000 by end of August. What's your reaction to Secretary Duque's clarification about flattening the curve?
Well, I did not hear about him claiming that the curve has flattened. But as far as we are concerned, the pandemic is still here. And that's the most important thing that we have to know. The pandemic is still here. We haven't gotten rid of the pandemic. And we still have a lot of work to do to solve this problem.
Mm-hmm. And are we still in the first wave of infections while other countries are seeing the second or third waves already? And under the same conditions right now, what do you think the trend will be?
Well, if we are on the first wave, we haven't flattened the curve. And that's what our view of this is right now. We're still on the first wave. All over the country, it's still the first wave. Some are starting to have transmissions. Community transmission is uneven in the entire country, and we can see some emerging hotspots. For example, Basilan and Leyte, and also parts of Calabarzon and Central Luzon. So, but the main battlegrounds are still in NCR and Cebu province. However, we noted that Cebu has actually improved a lot since 30 days ago. So the reproduction number R has actually gone down in Cebu. And this is a very positive sign. So we hope we can sustain that. And then we really need to work on NCR because the cases are surging in NCR, and we need to scale up our testing and also our isolation and maybe localized lockdowns. Mm-hmm.
So in this case, do you support the extension of the GCQ for Metro Manila, and will this help flatten the curve?
We support the extension. We are hopeful that it will flatten the curve. We support the extension because right now the critical care in Metro Manila is reaching danger levels. So we're over 70% occupancy in beds and ICUs in Metro Manila. So they are coming up with some solutions like increasing beds capacity for hospitals, and of course increased testing. So these are the things that are being done to help us maybe flatten the curve, but we will see after 15 days where we are. So that's what we do here. We monitor. We don't just make projections, but we will also monitor the state of the pandemic in these places like NCR and Cebu and Calabarzon.
There's a new story in the U.S. about how it's possible to be COVID positive in an enclosed space and not infect others. And at the same time, the WHO considering the possibility that the virus is airborne. Mathematically, what is the more likely scenario?
There is a lot of information that is coming out about COVID. So it's a very new form of the virus, and it's only been around for a few months now. So we're still learning a lot about it. I can't say about the likelihood of which one is more likely. It does seem more like, but at least from a personal standpoint, it seems more likely that the virus is airborne, because if we look at the high-risk activities and the increased transmission, these occur in crowded places and in enclosed places, and that may include MRT. So in fact, there is, based on what I have researched, there is not a lot of cases where in an outdoor setting there were community transmissions. They can happen if it's a crowded outdoor setting, for example, in a sports stadium or in a marketplace. But generally, if you're outdoors, it's actually less risky than if you are in an enclosed space like maybe a restaurant. And the one of the other factors is the time you spend in that place. So if you spend a long time lingering there, like 1 hour or 2 hours, your risks increase.
Mm-hmm. Well, the health department has made several adjustments to their mode of reporting. Do you agree with the current method of reporting? And what numbers are we supposed to be focusing on? Should it be the number of new infections or those currently infected? Is it the death toll that's supposed to be going down, or are we still looking at doubling time?
Actually, all the factors you mentioned are all very important. So it's important for us to look at these indicators. They can tell different stories. The death rate, the case fatality rate has been decreasing, but at the same time, we have to monitor it because some of the later cases, for example, in Cebu, they're now starting to have a higher death rate compared to before. So the unevenness in community transmissions is a factor here. So we also have to look at recovery rate, which is very important, and doubling time, which is related to what we look at, the reproduction number or the R. And then we have to look at the number of new cases, and some of these are lagged, but we still look at them. So we don't just look at one set of data. We look at everything, and then based on that, we make the analysis and the projections. If we have more data, we can actually do more. So again, we're hoping to get like a localized, more granular data from a barangay level and something like that.
Mm-hmm. Which you're not getting yet. Is there a way to speed up the delivery of that kind of information? What trends are you seeing being done in other countries that are able to more effectively report and control and the spread of the virus that may be worth implementing here?
Well, we've looked at some of the things that other countries did, for example, in Japan and in Vietnam. Some of the countries that have been successful, they relied a lot on preventive measures, very, very proactive preventive measures, and of course, wearing of masks and other stuff. Those things, social distancing are important, but they also did a lot of contact tracing. It would be very difficult for us now to do contact tracing at this level. It's because the number of cases is already too high, and there are a lot of asymptomatics that we haven't detected. So we still need to increase testing, maybe do more of random testing. I actually also welcome maybe using rapid test kits instead of the PCR, which are a lot more expensive. But so far, I think we've been trying to replicate what other countries have done. So we've, you know, managed to do a lockdown, started opening up. We do have to look at some of the transportation modes that we are offering, for example, MRT and buses, because like I mentioned, enclosed spaces seem to be a more likely source of transmission. That being said, there is also news that, or at least some information that the virus may already have mutated, and this was also mentioned by one of our colleagues, and I think they are in the process of sequencing the new virus and to check if it is already a new form, because the virus has already mutated in Europe, and we are suspecting that maybe this new virus is already, this new coronavirus mutation is already present in the Philippines.
Dr. David, at a time when supposing that a vaccine is already found, have you made projections on how long before a vaccine would be able to effectively, probably not eliminate the number of COVID cases, but diminish it so that the risk to life would be also brought down?
Yeah, the idea with vaccination, if we can't vaccinate everyone, we can do a sort of a population-based vaccination wherein we test not the whole population, but a certain portion, and then the rest will be based on herd immunity. And in that way, we can vaccinate just a smaller number of people. In fact, one of my co-authors, Father Nicanor, he actually has a design for vaccine delivery once we have this vaccine available. I can't say I'm very optimistic about when this vaccine will be available. It might be, we might get surprised, it might come in the next 6 months, but realistically speaking, I won't be expecting one within about 1 year.
Mm-hmm. But supposing that a cure or a vaccine is found, it still won't eliminate the virus immediately. You will expect, is it correct that you will have to expect that it may take months, if not years, before the risk or the threat of the virus will have been diminished?
Actually, based on studies, once we have the vaccine, it should be relatively quick as long as we're able to collectively use this on the masses, on the people, and vaccinate a sufficient number or proportion of the people, then we may be able to get rid of the virus fairly quickly. I would be talking about like 1 to 2 months only. So this would be a fairly quick process, assuming, of course, that this vaccine is potentially reliable and has a high degree of success.
Mm-hmm. Finally, Dr. David, the move of government of going house to house in search of possible COVID patients, do you approve of this move? And what results do you expect from this? Won't this actually expose our health workers as well as our authorities to more vulnerability?
We support the idea of having a randomized testing. We've been pushing for something like that. Now, the house-to-house is something. It's an implementation issue, and we are not sure about the implementation. The implementation characteristics of doing a house-to-house and the risks involved. And I think we have to consider this very carefully before we do something like this. There might be other ways which would actually be more effective or superior. But again, we haven't really looked at this mode of implementation. We do support randomized testing, but I think they could do this maybe for known cases who are isolated or who are having quarantine, and then have them isolated in an isolation facility. But doing house to house, we are not sure if this may be what you might call overkill, or if it will be. It might be effective, but as you mentioned, there might also be some risks of overexposing our health workers who are already overexposed enough as it is.
Mm-hmm. And you're saying that there might be other ways superior to doing a house-to-house randomized testing. Would you care to share with us what other possible ways there might be to conduct that?
Well, if you're doing a rapid antibody testing, which you can do very quickly, it could be available. It could be made available in places like, you could have kiosks where we could do that, and then people, like, let's say, passing by. Because again, what we have to really look at would be people with high mobility, because these are the people who are very likely to come into contact with a lot of people. So it's not necessarily that if you're at home and they knock at your door that you're a high risk for transmitting the virus, because you may be just there, you may be, you know, going out to just a few places, so you may not be a what you call a potential super spreader. So what we really need to be looking at maybe is people with potential for us becoming a super spreader and moving around a lot. So these are the kinds of people. I'm not saying these people are, you know, to be discriminated or anything. I'm just saying these people have a higher risk of getting the virus because they're moving around a lot. And mobility is one of the main drivers of this virus, and that's how people get infected, because people are more mobile. And that's one of the ways, or one of the reasons why the community quarantine was effective, because it kept us from being mobile. So once we have people with more mobility, then they are at high risk. And I think these people are better suited to be randomized, to be subjected to randomized testing.
That's a good point right there, and we definitely take that into guidance. Dr. Guido David of the UP Institute of Mathematics and a fellow of the OCTA Research, thank you so much for sharing your insights with us.
Thank you, Ms. Rain. Good afternoon. And